Agus chosin an thod an hín, áte an na nechtri.
It's Christmas time. There's no need to be afraid.
So I spent 4 days in my studio piecing together these totally incompatible ideas that Bob and I came up with, while Bob ran up a massive phone bill, phoning the artists and getting them to come and commit to turning up on the day to do the bit that we all saw.
Was it true that Boy George was phoned up and was flown across the Atlantic on Concorde?
Yeah, he was in New York and they'd been having a good time, I think, and Bob woke him up and said, get your backside on Concorde. And he was there. He got there by 7, 8 o'clock in the evening, came in and did his vocal. When they turned up, I still hadn't assigned who was singing which lines. I didn't know who was going to be there, so we started off with Paul Young, and then we'd kind of cut halfway through a line and pick up with someone else, and you know, and so we were assigning the parts as we went, so kind of making it up on the fly. Well, tonight, thank God it's them instead of you. And there won't be snow. But by the time they all got there to come and do it, they'd all seen the footage. They knew why we were doing it, and you couldn't not know what was happening at this point. So they turned up with the right intent. The amazing thing is that they turned up at all, mm-hmm. because we didn't talk to the record companies, we didn't talk to the management companies, we talked artist to artist. Of course, artists are, they're a bit flaky. And they're
maybe
not very
that's
reliable.
The trick.
I don't know. But they turned up.
Did you go across?
I went with the... Either Bob or I had to go with the first shipment of emergency goods that the Band-Aid money raised. And I went out, and the weird thing is that I went to Addis Ababa, the capital, and they took me to some lovely, five-star, four-star hotel to freshen up. And I'm thinking, this is bizarre, this is not what I've seen on television. Being a bit naive, and I'm looking out the window and there's people sitting around a swimming pool, and I thought, I don't get this. Yet half an hour in a Land Rover, I was in an aid camp.
What does it feel like?
It was really odd. The whole thing was very odd, you know? There's people there who had the hideous job of standing at the gates every morning and choosing who they could help. And therefore, in a reverse manner, condemning people to die. Because there's kids that they just couldn't help. And they had to choose. And these are young girls, these are young nurses who had to do this. So it was hideous. I'm a guy from Canvas Lang and the outskirts of Glasgow. I'm not cut out for that. Then again, neither are they. You know, you get the visual part of Band Aid and Live Aid, and then you get Live Eight 20 years later, you know. But that 20-year gap, we've still been funding, you know, umpteen projects, thousands upon thousands of projects, you know, assessing them, reassessing them, you know, analysing what it is that they're actually trying to achieve. You know, all of that stuff has been going on all that time. That was our job, you know, and every so often pop up on the television and remind people it hasn't gone away.
Does it get you to ask yourself, you know, soul-searching questions, I suppose, you know?
I can't sit and analyse it too much. And, you know, people say, oh, you must be really proud of it. And you're like, well, yeah, when I think about it, I'm really proud of it. It's fantastic that it happened. I'm proud of the events. I'm proud of the records happening. The record's not the greatest record in the world, but it achieved an amazing thing. It wasn't just a musical moment. It was a social moment. You know, we all saw it. That wouldn't have happened unless your average guy in the street was moved by the images he saw. And he was looking at his own family. You know, things like, you know, people used to stop you in the street and stick tenors in your top pockets. They send that to Africa. And you're like, oh, Jesus, don't give me money. I don't want... A woman came and gave... An old woman gave her wedding ring to Bob. She was in her 70s. That's all she had. She wanted to give that. You think moments like that, to move people like that is just incredible. So that movement, that whatever it was that was in the air, you know, was paramount to the whole thing working. You know, if that wasn't there, if that essence wasn't there, it doesn't matter how good the record was or how many pop stars were on it, it wouldn't have done what it did.
Hamir fel ych fismyn ych gyfel band-aid agos Midge Hain has the cymalt glwchiaid yn hathachod am Ethiopia. Hanna jalan sy'n eich asgo chiefi agos cho cwach gych yn jw, sef ad ffichyd bleol na ddys.
It's quite interesting to see that when you go back and you view that stuff, you think, it was the start of climate change. The rains fail, the crops don't grow, famine. And for 25 years since then, the rains fail, the crops don't grow, famine.
Are these subjects recurrent themes in some of the music that you're writing now? You know, do you draw on those years and those experiences?
Whether it's directly, I'm not sure I do anything that's directly about that. I mean, I probably have done a couple of things in the past when it was high on the agenda and therefore very fresh in my mind. What I tend to do is question a lot. I question my religious upbringing in Glasgow. I question, you know, most fixed religions and what they're actually trying to achieve. I question politicians. I don't trust them, you know. And I find that they're great subject matter. So I question a lot about what I was taught as a kid. You know, what's right and wrong. You do this, you'll go to heaven, and you'll all be lovely, and it'll be wonderful. And I question people's motives when they do things. Same way the media questioned what we were doing when Band-Aid happened. Religion seems to have caused more anguish in the world than good, I think, I see. So therefore I question why it's happening. Look at the conflicts that are happening in the world right now. And it boils down to, you know, one side hating the other because of religion. We're sitting in Belfast and I've seen the difference where, you know, people are starting to enjoy the peace here. And that's amazing. And that wasn't done with religion, that was done by putting religious elements on the back burner. And people talking to people, and that's what's important to me, I think.
We've come a long and circuitous route to this, and we're now really philosophical, and you're preparing to go on stage at the Empire tonight.
Yeah.
For fear of leaving with no voice at all, let me just say a huge thanks for spending time with us today, and to wish you the best tonight. We should be in the audience at some point, so thanks once again.
Thank you. No shout now.
I'm saying nothing. Wel, gymiorst yn ychyrwgw eddagol ac i enw Cwnag Rhym agos Begyn Hienig, o'r gyd na chael colon y tord Ciol Taica, hag yw hein y Lienig Natalwch.